to the rock of our salvation. Oh, come, let us worship our God. Oh, come, let us worship our God. Oh, come, let us sing to our God. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Oh, come, let us worship our God.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. Good to see you this morning. It feels like it's been a while since we've actually been here in this place, so it's great to be here. Any announcements this morning for the good of the whole community? Anything going on this month or this week? All right. Wow. That might be a first. Well, welcome. It's good to see you today. I'll invite you to rise with me and let us worship God together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for nurturing and caring for us like a mother hen, like a mother dove. Bring us into your wings this morning, O God. Comfort us when we are in pain. And when we need a challenge, push us in your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Together, let us confess our sin and come to God for healing. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings at war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In his desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Children of God, hear the good news this day. God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sins no more. By grace we have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing, your sins are forgiven. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. Let us pray. O God, our teacher and guide, you draw us to yourself and welcome us as beloved children. Help us to lay aside all envy and selfish ambition, that we may walk in your ways of wisdom and understanding as servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Please share with one another the peace of Christ.
Good morning. Is that okay? Okay. Our first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 11, verses 18 through 20. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew, then you showed me their evil deeds. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter, and I did not know it was against me, that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord. And our psalm is Psalm 54. Save me, O God, by your name. In your might, defend my cause. For strangers have risen up against me, and the ruthless have sought my life, those who have no regard for God. Render evil to those who spy on me. In your faithfulness, destroy them. For you have rescued me from every trouble, and my eyes look down on my enemies. Our second reading is from James chapter 3. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness, born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. and you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your own pleasures. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. The word of the Lord.
This is the gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. When Jesus came to the disciples, he saw a great crowd around them, and some scribes also were arguing with them. Now when the whole crowd saw Jesus, they were immediately overcome with awe, and they ran forward to greet him. So Jesus asked them, "What are you arguing about this day?" Someone from the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak. And whenever it seizes him, it dashes him down, and he foams and grinds his teeth and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to cast it out, but they couldn't do it." Jesus answered them, "You faithless generation, how much longer must I be among you? How much longer must I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." And they brought the one to him, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell on the ground and rolled about, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And the man said to him, "From childhood. It has often cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you are able to do anything, have pity on us and help us." Jesus said to him, "If you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes." Immediately, the father of the child cried out, "I believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You, spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." And after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out. And the boy was like a dead person, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he was able to stand. And when he had entered the house, the disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out?" Jesus said to them, "This kind can come out only through prayer." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Today I want to consider one important question in our lives. When in your life have you been disappointed with God? And what does it mean for our faith when we are disappointed with God? I know that many of you are frequent prayers. You pray for loved ones, you pray for people who are sick, you pray for the poor and the hungry, you pray for the world. And I also think that there are times when our prayers go deeper than just asking God for something. Have you ever noticed this? There are prayers that we pray in our lives that sometimes come from a deeper place. A place not merely of asking, but of pleading, almost begging. Some of our prayers sometimes come deep from within our hearts or our souls even. These prayers come sometimes at times of change or loss, sometimes at a time of grief or confusion. These prayers of the heart, prayers of the soul, become times when we're like grabbing onto God, maybe even shaking our fist at God. Prayers, you might say, of desperation. Well, in our gospel reading this morning, we hear a story about a man who is desperate, a man who has prayed prayers of desperation. I wonder how many of you have heard this story of this man and this son before. Just by showing of hands, was this story familiar to any of you, to many of you, to any of you? Some of you have heard it. Some of you, most have not. I was actually surprised to find out that this story is not in the lectionary, so it's not in our 3-year cycle of readings. So I wanted to spend some time with it today because, well, it has one of, I think, the best lines in the whole Bible. And also because the thing that happens to this man, who I think is kind of the main character, is something that I think happens to each and every one of us at some point in our lives. You see, this man is a man who has a son. And this son has what we might today call epilepsy. This man's son is beset by seizures, what we might call seizures. He's foaming at the mouth. He's taken over by convulsing. And, of course, in their day, they would have had no word for this and certainly no medical definition. And so this man is trying to do anything he can to help his son. And it seems that he's tried everything. Getting a little feedback there. This man, he's tried everything, it seems, because this boy seems to have been beset by these seizures for a long time. At Bible study on Friday, we discovered, and Linda pointed out for the first time that I never noticed before, when Jesus asks this man, how long has this been happening? How long has this been going on? The man responds, since childhood. Now, the son is also called a boy, but it could be that this man's son has actually been beset by this disease, by this evil spirit for many years. In fact, it may be true that this man's son is actually a grown adult who is now needing continued care because he can't care for himself anymore. It's possible that this father has cared for this for his son for years, maybe even decades. And it's not just taking care of him, it's also protecting him. The story says that this son, that this disease doesn't just cause him fits of seizure. It also casts him into fire and into water. So you can imagine if this son has been cast into fire and water, this father has probably had to go get him out of a fire and go pull him out of water to rescue him from drowning. These fits of seizure appear in the story to not only be physical. If they're casting him into fire and water, then there's also something darker, something that Mark calls an evil spirit, a demon. And so this man seems to have tried everything. And so he tries once more to find healing for his son. And And he tries to do this by going to Jesus. But first, and you know, there's a lot of that's tough about this story. This is the one part of this story that I find quite amusing. The man first has to before he can get to Jesus, has to get through the wall of the disciples. And we've read in other stories, the disciples, they usually don't get it, right? They're usually kind of clueless. They focus on the wrong things. They argue about the wrong things. They think about the wrong things. But in this story, I feel like the disciples deserve a little bit of pity, don't you? I mean, the disciples, they receive this man's son, and they want to do the right thing. They actually try to do the right thing. They try to lay hands on him and heal him. But they just can't. They just don't have the power or the ability to offer healing to this man's son. And so this crowd has gathered around, and you can imagine Peter, the hothead that he is, getting a little bit embarrassed that they can't do these things that Jesus has already done. They can't find the way to heal this man's son. And so there's this argument that's beginning to brew among the scribes and the crowd and the disciples. And Jesus overhears this argument, whatever he had been doing, comes and joins them and says, "What are you arguing about?" And of course, the man who really needs the help, he's the one who answers. And he responds and says, "Sir, I brought to your disciples my son, but they couldn't heal him." Then Jesus and have this conversation. And Jesus finds out more. He finds out how long this has been going on, what's happening to the son. This is one of the longest healing stories in the whole Gospel of Mark, because Jesus and him have this conversation about it. And then when they're getting close to the end of the conversation, the man says, if you can help him, please heal him and have pity on us. And Jesus says, if you can. And if you can, that could be if I can. I think, though, it might actually be a challenge to the disciples, right? If you can. If you can. Jesus, remember, over his whole ministry, is not merely healing and teaching. He's also preparing the disciples to do exactly what they were trying to do, to continue and carry on Jesus' ministry after he was gone. And this is in chapter 9, right after the Transfiguration. John and Peter had just seen Jesus up on a mountain being transfigured before them. So they know that something is up. Something is up with this Jesus. Something is going to happen. Jesus is beginning to point them, okay, I'm not going to be here forever. Soon this will be your ministry and the ministry of the church. But for right now, Jesus in person is the only one who can do anything. And so he says, if you can, anything can be done for the one who believes. And I want you to listen. I'm going to read again this verse. I want you to listen to the end of this conversation. What does this man say in response to Jesus? Jesus said to the Father, if you are able, all things can be done for the one who believes. Immediately, the Father cried out, saying, I believe. Help me with my unbelief. I believe. Help me with my unbelief. I honestly think we could right here. For anyone who's ever doubted, for anyone who's ever believed but wrestled with God, for anyone who's ever been disappointed with God, we could simply say this for the rest of our lives. Lord, I believe. Help me with my unbelief. It's a way of holding together faith and doubt, belief and disbelief, all at the same time, and allowing God to hold it. And we could just stop right there. But there's more here, I think. After the healing, Jesus takes aside the disciples and they go into this house. And the disciples ask him, again, they're trying to get it. They're really doing their best, the disciples. And so they ask him, Jesus, like, you were able to do this. Why couldn't we do this? Why couldn't we heal this man's son? And Jesus replies, this kind can only come out through prayer. So first, we see that Jesus seems to know something about the spiritual realm, the realm of spirits, of evil and good, the realm beyond the physical. He seems to know something that we do not, that the disciples do not. But also, Jesus says something that's a challenge to us. This kind can come out through prayer. I mean, I imagine the disciples said, well, didn't we pray for this man? Like, didn't we ask God to help us heal him? And the Father, if he had heard these words, they were in private, but if he had been there, surely he would have said too, I've prayed for years for my son. Why hasn't God healed him before now? Honestly, anyone in the church, any of you, might ask the same question. Jesus, I have prayed from my heart. I have prayed time and time again. Why have you not heard me? Why have you been silent? I think the answer comes in part from what prayer truly is in the Gospel of Mark. The primary examples of prayer in Mark are first at the very beginning of the Gospel, when Jesus goes out into the wilderness. And there he's tempted by the devil, and for 40 days he wrestles not only with evil, but also with God and who God is calling Jesus to be. So there's this 40 days of wrestling in the wilderness, and then right before his crucifixion, Jesus goes to Gethsemane. And in Gethsemane, Jesus prays. But remember that prayer, the first thing that Jesus prays is actually, Lord, if it's possible, take this cup from me. Jesus asks God, prays that Jesus wouldn't have to go through what he was about to go through at Calvary. Jesus' prayer, his request, goes completely unanswered. You see, prayer, I think, in the Gospel of Mark and in our lives is actually less about just what we ask, just what we plead for, even our prayers of the heart. Prayer is more about our relationship of trust with a God whom we know loves and cares for us. Prayer is more like wrestling with God than it is a magic box where we can turn a screw, turn a lever, and get what we want. Prayer is maybe the core act of faith, because faith is about a relationship of trust. When have you been most disappointed with God? Maybe it was something years and years ago. Maybe you're still disappointed from that moment. Maybe that time for you is right now. Well, I want you to know this. No matter what your disappointment comes from, God's love and grace remains for you. Earlier, I asked, what does it mean to have faith? What does our faith mean when our prayers go unanswered, when we're disappointed? And I think it has to do everything to do with trusting that God's promises, God's true promises, God's foundational bedrock, never to be shaken promises, will be there for us, whether our prayers are answered the way we want them to, or whether we are disappointed. Because God's bedrock promises, God's foundational promises, go beyond what we ask for, what we hope for, even what we yearn most deeply from our heart for. Because God's foundational promises go beyond this life. I want to read for you one more verse from this story again, because it points, I think, to what these bedrock promises truly are. Jesus said to the unclean spirit, "You, spirit that keeps this boy from speaking and hearing, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." After crying out and convulsing the boy terribly, it came out, and the boy was like a dead person, so that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he was able to stand. Even when we think that someone we love is gone, even when we know that death has had, for now, the last word on someone's life, Jesus will raise them up. Jesus will raise them up. Jesus will raise them up because Jesus was raised up. And so Jesus promises to us, we will be raised up. If not in this life, then in the next. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to invite our young disciples to join me. You want to come up, Kayla? Come on. Okay. Well, we'll miss you. Oh, hi, Hailey. Hi, Mason. How are you guys doing today? Good. So what did you think of this story that we read today? Story about the father and the son who had these fits that he couldn't control. What did you think of that story? You thought some things? Yeah. What do you think it was like for the dad whose loved one had this problem that they couldn't fix? Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm my son being possessed, or is there something wrong with him? Because they didn't know what it was at the time.
They didn't know what it was at the time.
A lot of stuff was like people being possessed at that time, so it was probably like, oh no.
Probably very panicked, yeah. Probably every time it happened, he probably felt some panic. Yeah, what do you think it was like for the son, for the guy who had these things happen to him?
Not fun.
Not fun. Maybe painful. Yeah. Yeah, when things happen to us that we can't control. Yeah, it's painful. It's not fun. I imagine it might have been panicky it might have invoked some panic for him too. And, you know, it doesn't take too much imagination to think that the dad and maybe even the son too prayed for a long time for this to go away. So we talked about today what happens when our prayers aren't answered, or when God doesn't answer our prayers in the way that we want them to. So I got a tough question for you guys. You guys are both in confirmation now, so you're ready for tough questions. Do you think if our prayers aren't always answered the way we want them to, does that mean that we shouldn't pray? Because not everything can go the way you want it to. Yeah, that's good thinking. So why should we pray then? If our prayers aren't, if it's not magic, if it's not always as simple as ask God for something and we get it. Why ask at all?
Because it's good and it builds your faith and relationship with God.
It's good. It builds your faith and relationship with God. Yeah, I'm not sure I could have said it any better, Eileen. That's really well said. Mason, what do you think? Why would you pray even if we don't always get what we want?
So we can still believe in God?
So we can still believe in God. Yeah. Yeah, I think prayer is kind of acting out our belief in God. It's putting our belief, our faith into practice. And there's one more thing, too. I mean, Jesus in this story, you know, these people prayed for a long time for this son to be healed. And yet Jesus invited the disciples to keep praying anyway. I think that God invites us to pray and invites us to pray with faith that we'll be heard, even though it doesn't always work out the way we want it to. Like, I think God takes our prayers and uses them in a way, even if it's not the way that we want it to. So, we've been talking a lot about prayer. How about we have a prayer together? You want to pray with me? Okay. You can repeat after me. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the gift of prayer. Encourage us in faith. And comfort us in disappointment. Help us to trust in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming. I invite you to rise with me in body or in spirit and join with me in confessing your faith in the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord.
Born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified,
drawn together in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray with confidence for the church, for God's good creation, and all who are in need. Let us pray. Loving God, you welcome all at your table of grace. Instill in your church, in this place and across the world, a spirit of humility and curiosity, that we may embrace all who seek you and all who cry out to you. We pray especially for ministries of hospitality and faith formation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Creating God, you have shaped your world so there is more than enough for all. We pray today for those who are hungry, for those who are poor, and for those who are lonely. Help your abundance of food and relationship be enough for all. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Gracious God, your peace brings justice and solidarity to all those who are in need. Encourage peace among all nations and all peoples. Heal divisions in our country and across the world. Today we pray especially for those grieving in Lebanon, in Palestine, in Israel, in Ukraine, in Russia, in Sudan, in Yemen, and everywhere where people are grieving the loss of life. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Faithful God, you draw near to all who are in need. Bring healing and wholeness to all who suffer, especially those who are sick, those who are wrestling with things beyond their control, and those who need your healing. We pray for those in our hearts, those who cry out, including those we name before you now. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting that you know and hear each one, and that you take our prayers and use them for good. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Merciful God, you embrace us on our final pilgrimage from this life. Accompany all who have died, console all who mourn, and at the last, show us the way to eternal life in you, for you have been raised up. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We entrust these and all our prayers to you, Holy God, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We offer our hearts, our minds, our tithes, and all that is good to God.
What have we to offer? What have we?
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, and we should give thanks in all times and all places. We give you thanks, O God, for this bread and for this cup, for we trust that you are here with us forever. Let's do Holy, Holy. Go ahead.
Full of your glory, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
God, you are indeed holy. You are holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but might have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took a cup. He gave thanks and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this and drink it. This is the cup of the new covenant, which is for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, for all are welcome, and all is now ready. Please be seated.
We eat this bread and drink this cup until you
Let us pray. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Children of God, receive now this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. One, two, three, go.
Okay. By cross of so your peace.
Go in peace, follow Jesus. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen.
This I know, when everything falls apart.